There are only two types here, the smart and the dumb. The smart believe that there can't possibly be anything intrinsically important, super important that they've overlooked. So there's no point in even trying listening about or searching, looking, listening, trying, paying attention. There's no point to it. This is, okay, that's the smart. The dumb say that they can't understand anything important anyway, so there's no point in even trying. And this is what we have here in the world. Then there's this indeterminateness which we're relaxing into. So don't try to label that. Just let it be the indeterminateness. Some say the maverickness. It just does, you know, it just doesn't. It just can't be really determined what it is. But the world, as far as the world goes, again, the smart people, their entire self-confidence is built up on the notion that there isn't anything of real significant value and importance that they've overlooked. They pretty much know it all, and they're just accessorizing their know-it-allness. That's their life. And the dumb say that even if there was something extremely important, they couldn't understand it anyway, so they don't need to pay attention. That's pretty much it. And then there's just this indeterminateness. There's just this wowness. Okay, and then there's the wowness. But this is not a person. This is not a people. This is just the wowness. So let the world appear as just this wowness. Don't pursue being smart or dumb. Just let the appearance of the world, let the world appear to us in a certain way. The appearance of intrinsic spaciousness, just let that relax into that. Let whatever smartness and dumbness we have been posing as, just let that all be exactly as it is right now, and just relax into this, the wowness of the world appears just as this beautiful a decoration of intrinsic spaciousness. Now, the practice, the way to do this is to always go to practice as if you're going to be wowed, plain and simple. Now, ultimately, of course, our goal is to choose this different perception, different form of perception. Perception's actually a form. Choose a different form of perception so that everything appears different to us. It appears much, much, much more beautiful and indescribable. It appears as entirely indescribable, entirely indeterminate, just intrinsic spaciousness and the decorations of that. So this is just a wow. So always, we're allowing ourselves to feel more of this wow. Like, yes, I can do this. Yes, I will do this. Yes, I've already done it. So we don't go in trying to collect explanations. Truth is completely inexplicable because it's entirely indeterminate. It's just to be experienced, not to be explained. Only structure can be explained. Only the belief in determinism gives rise to explanations, questions, searching, learning, understanding, all of that. Reality has nothing to learn, nothing to understand, nothing to explain. It's pure experiencing. So we allow this pure perception where we're simply acclimatizing ourselves to the notion that we can, we will, we already are experiencing pure perception. So the best practice is to get to this, I'm already experiencing it. And this brings up this wow. I have a friend whose motto is fake it until you make it. Well, this is essentially great advice in that we as if we are already experiencing this. We use our imagination, not trying to imagine it, but actually believing that we are already there. We believe it. So we don't even need to imagine it, we're already there. So we practice already there-ness. This is the highest practice, is already there-ness. Simply practicing that. Now, if we have the will to do that, it's very great, but our will tends to oscillate a little bit. You know, we have a lot sometime and not so much another. Okay, that's fine. But we have to keep on rallying our will to set down all paths, explanations, teachings, learnings, all of that, religions, ways, and say, I'm already here. And merely allow, feel as if, believe that you're already here. Don't try to do some sort of imagination where you're building up visualizations and all this kind of stuff. No, you're already here. You already have pure perception. So, you've already reached the full completion stage. Nothing to visualize. And since your practice is to advocate to others to practice already here, there's no explanations needed, is there? Not really. Just practice that you're already beyond the need for any explanation. So the answer to all questions is just practice that you're already beyond the need for asking for any answers. You're actually experiencing pure perception right now. And deep within us, we're saying, ah, this is great. I didn't realize we could do this. See, I didn't feel I had the permission to do this. Well, As having an official position in the court of the Dharma King Longchenpa, as a Dharma prince, I have the responsibility to give out permission to practice this way. So I'm giving out the permission to practice in this way. I could have been practicing this way all along. Yes, that's correct. But we didn't feel we had the right, we felt we had to follow some teacher, some teaching, some way, this, and that. But really, the teachers really are just telling us, practice in this way. And we also realize this is the remedy, isn't it, for all the troubles that are inherent within this, whatever you want to call it, this effort to transform reality into determinancy, structure, process, value, time, space, process, and form, valuing, crystallization, structure, all this, the attempt to change reality. All of the conflict inherent with that, because it necessitates projection. Projection generates conflict. So this whole egocentric, sensory perception centric, body centric dream inherently generates conflict. There's no way around that at all. So the idea of bringing peace to the world is ridiculous. Total waste of time. That's the religions of dualism believe in bringing peace to the world. Bringing peace to sensory perception, really? That's entirely impossible. The conflict, all you do is you're pushing conflict here, pushing it there, pushing it there, pushing it there. You never get anywhere. You it's amazing. If you could just see, you scapegoat this group, and then you scapegoat this group, and then you scapegoat this group, and you keep thinking, no, we're bringing peace, because look at this group now. They're no longer scapegoated. They finally are starting to find peace. Yeah, but I say, wait a minute. There's this whole huge, large group that have been completely thrown under the bus and scapegoated. Oh, but we're not paying any attention to that. You know, the blindness, it's amazing. Same old, same old, same old. But if you're not part of the group that's being scapegoated, you think, oh, we're making progress. But if you are part of it, you realize there's no progress being made at all. This is the same old going on in this world, always. What appears to us through sensory perception will have this dynamic in our mind, always the same, always the same. And we just try to avoid. I don't want to be in the group that gets scapegoated, gets targeted. Frustrations get projected upon them. And I say, you're the one that needs to be healed, needs to be pulverized, to return us to intrinsic spaciousness, which is just a way of saying that we've been able to structure reality. The whole idea of fixing reality, or fixing something, is it really a statement that there's something to be fixed, which means reality isn't perfect. So don't try to fix anything. Don't try to heal anything. Don't try to do anything except realize you already have this pure perception. That's it. Leave all attempts to do anything exactly as they are and shift your perception to clear light vision of intrinsic spaciousness. So, it's easy practice, actually. It's not difficult. It's just that we feel we haven't really given permission to practice in this way. Maybe we'll hurt someone's feelings if we practice in this way or whatever. No. So the real teaching is simply a permission, approval and permission, encouragement to simply practice in this way. So nothing has to be done at all. Except to accept this is we see we're already, it's because we're already here. Why do we have to do something? We're already here. We already have pure perception. We're already abiding in pure perception. We just have to keep on this way, like this. Now this brings up a strain and a wow. It's just, this is why we sit quietly. It helps us endure this. It helps us stay in touch with it too. So we can feel this is really getting to the heart of it. We're already at the heart of it. We're not even getting there at all. We're already there. So there's no question about how do we get there. The answer to all questions, how do we get there? We're already there. There is no how do we get there. We are where we've always been. We're just accepting the fact that it's just acceptance. There's no how to it. It's just acceptance that we never left where we've always been. We've never created any determinancy at all. This is so All questions are based on the premise that how do we get rid of determinacy? And what we say is there's never been an iota of determinacy ever. So we have this, we stand on this fundamental premise, and the questions are adopting a false premise. How did we get rid of, how did we fix, how did we heal? No, there's never been anything wrong. There's never been anything to fix. There's never been any determinacy arising at all. Not any. We mistake our repetitive requests for experiencing and structure and having them in such a way of this display, creative display, we mistake that for determinacy. So if we want this glass bottle to appear, keep appearing this way, we think that it's somehow crystallized. It has not. Nothing ever crystallizes. No display ever is ever in a crystallized, determinate state whatsoever. Nothing has ever been that way. Well, this is how to practice. This is where our focus has to be. And really nowhere else. Anywhere else, and we're right back adopting a false premise that at least some crystallization has taken place. We just need to find that crystallization and pulverize it back into non-crystallization, which is why we have this Pharisaical self-righteousness, which Jesus, adamantly has pointed out is the false way. It's false. Any way is false because it's a searching for something that is not right that we have to fix. As Punjaji said, call off the search. This is shorthand. Drop the search. I had a very interesting experience last night as I was going to sleep, dropping off, drowsing, dropping off, and wake up a little bit. Just, I had this. Someone came up to me. I had this razor blade, one of those, four razor blade little cartridge, razor blade cartridge, and someone snatched it from my hand and ran away. I was thinking, hey, that's my razor blade. You can't have that. And I started getting upset and angry, and I felt like I need to go chase after this thief and yell and get it back. And suddenly it popped into my mind, it's a lot easier just to manifest another one. So instantly I decided I'm going to have another a razor blade, this cartridge in my hand, and poof, instantly it was in my hand. I say, oh, I don't have to go chase after any thief. I don't have to get upset. Nobody can steal anything from me without me being able to instantly manifest another one effortlessly. And it's just this big wow. In fact, I realized that even if everything is being stolen from me ceaselessly, I still have everything. I can never be depleted in any way. It's impossible for us to experience any depletion. So we have this dream of this thief stealing everything from us. But we must not chase after anything at all, for we still have everything. So this practice is another way of saying we still have everything, even though this world seems to be dispossessing us of so much. It's just a dream of dispossession is all it is. Keep in mind that the so-called future, that's just a dream of dispossession. Everything we see in this world, look about you, every last thing we are see here will be turned into dust, okay? Will be pulverized. The world is just this pulverizing machine that we imagine all these forms, and then and this dynamics just pulverize it. All mountains are being pulverized. Everything's being pulverized. Even diamonds can be pulverized, right? And melted down and returned to dust. This is just a dream of dispossession. But nothing can deprive us of anything. So we are resting on this truth and just having faith in it. This is really a faith-based practice that in spite of all what our dream shows us, we don't believe it at all. Okay, and we believe that there's no way we can ever be deprived of anything whatsoever. We can instantly have ask for a universe to arise, it will arise. We can never be deprived in any way. As long as we're chasing after the thief, though, we're believing that we can be deprived. What kind of mind chases after a thief? Why don't they just manifest whatever they want right now? When we're chasing after something, we're forgetting what we are. We're forgetting that we're mind, we're spirit. We're not things. We're not the display itself. As if it was, we're not anything crystallized at all. Nothing is crystallized. But when we're chasing after the thief, we're believing in crystallization. Meaning that the light has crystallized and lost its perfect instantaneous fluidity. That there has to be some process of pulverization take place first, some sort of process, in order for whatever we want to be present. This is absolutely not true. Nothing has to happen first. This is why we say there's only the now. All empowerment is in the now. Nothing at all has to take place first, meaning no time has to intervene at all between our request and the display of what we requested. The requested display. No, there's nothing intervening at all. So how could light be, say that light has some sort of form or quality like that? It's attributeless in that way. Ceaselessly attributeless, so that it therefore instantaneously any display at all appears to us, for us, as us. So it's the combination of these four Dharma kings that is helping us practice in this way. Because all of them get obscured through the traditions that have been built around them and have risen, or they're part of. Because there's the plausible inference of determinism that sensory perception always gives rise to. So even though they come in teaching the truth, sensory perception always overlays this plausible inference of determinism. And so we can get stuck in our own tradition. Most of us are stuck in our tradition. The tradition has become the obstacle because we're inferring at least some crystallization has had to take place. This is what happened with Christianity, is sensory perception kept saying, look, you've got to account for what I'm seeing. So they decide on duophysitism. Duophysitism, meaning two natures to Jesus, an uncrystallized nature and a crystallized nature, and saying that Jesus had this dualistic nature. This is entirely untrue. But this is the accommodations we make for sensory perception, saying, there has to be some, I can't be completely mistaken. I can't. Of course, sensory perception is completely mistaken, completely misleading. Well, it says, then you'll be without perception altogether. This is the lie, because the Holy Spirit has a perception for us, has perceiving for us. Well, see, the reason why we keep believing in the lies of sensory perception is we're ignorant of the fact that there's another form of perception for us, because we didn't make it. So we assume that we have to leap from sensory perception, from perception to no perception at all. And this gives rise to this vast continuity fear issue that we have. We say that's too much. That leap is too much. So the ignorance that we started this video by talking about how smart people, they think there's nothing vitally important they could be ignorant about. The truth is that all of us have been totally ignorant that there's this other form of perception that we have access to, that the Holy Spirit is keeping for us, keeps safe for us, and we can never get rid of it. It always has it for us. Even if we reject the Holy Spirit in the most hostile way for, trillions of years, whatever, it makes no difference to the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit still has this form of perception for us. It's the gift of God. God actually has a gift for us, and this gift is this perception, pure perception, the clear light perception of intrinsic spaciousness. This is a God's gift to us, which bridges the gap between perception and no perception at all, which between perception and knowing. Okay, between perception and knowing, we need to have that a bridge, because our continuity fear is too afraid to drop perception the way that because the way it is right now. Sensory perception. If we think there's nothing else, to go from sensory perception to knowing seems just like way too big of a leap for us. So what we're ignorant of is because we didn't make it, is there's another form of perception available to us. And again, you go here in the Silicon Valley area, you go to Stanford and ask everyone on the campus of Stanford, from the think tank fellowships all the way down to the undergraduates, all the teachers, professors, you name it. Ask every single one of them about this, and you would probably find that every single one of them is ignorant of this fact. And yet these are the people who are shaping your future. They're entirely ignorant of this essential, crucial fact. And they're demanding that you accept their vision of a future, of your destiny, as if it's as if it's the smartest one, as if it's not ignorant of any crucial facts at all. And therefore, you're bound to be happy if you follow their blueprint. You're bound to be happy. This is a scary thing, isn't it? Very scary. We don't quite realize that the blueprint for our future is being hammered out by these think tanks. There are many think tanks around the world, and they're extremely influential, and they're stalked by those who believe in determinism. And they're funded by these very powerful organizations people call the Bilderbergs, the Illuminati, the Trilateral Commission, the Tavistock, or Tavistock Institute's a think tank, for instance, very influential. It's in England. There are many of these think tanks that are stalked and funded by these, by the some people call it the Illuminati, the New World Order, whatever you want to call it. Very, very powerful, rich people. They select the brightest minds, quote unquote, the brightest determinist minds, and have these very influential think tanks. And these think tanks hammer out policy for the future. United Nations ha has their think tank, and they actually go to these think tanks for their policy. And then they have these, 17 sustainable, they have these sustainable development goals, 17 sustainable development goals. They have an entire blueprint hammered out for your future. The United Nations does. Very, very much set in stone already. This is something, again, most of us are ignorant about. The politicians get their policy from these think tanks, from these, they go to these meetings of these big organizations. Trilateral, Bilderberg, Club of Rome, on and on, which get their policy from these think tanks. And they decide then what the direction to take the countries, and to take the world and policy. They set policy. And then the bureaucracies implement this policy. So they then staff their cabinet and bureaucracies with those who agree with these policies. This is how it all works here. And yet, every single one of these people, if you go and ask them, are most likely entirely ignorant that the Holy Spirit has this other form of perception for us. The only ones that are aware of this are the Dharma kings like Jesus Christ, who's entirely aware of this. Someone like Longchenpa, who's entirely aware of this, pure perception. Pure perception is not just a arranging of sensory perception in a certain way. Not at all. Not at all. Jesus says you either are viewing sensory perception, or you're viewing the vision of oneness, vision of Christ, pure perception, the Holy Spirit's perception, which includes the objects that we're used to seeing. But it sees them as mere display of their own intrinsic spaciousness. So, if you're unaware of this, you will find your destiny controlled by, you will find, as you struggle for freedom of expression, all this, you will find it. You never, it's like you're following someone else's blueprint. Well, you are, actually, literally. The social engineering that takes place is extraordinary here. It comes from these think tanks. SRIs, another one, Stanford Research Institute, Hoover Institute, SRI, Stanford, enormously influential as far as the world we're experiencing right now actually was blueprinted by these think tanks decades ago. And they've already blueprinted the next couple decades. It's already in the pipeline. However, there are other there's other stuff in the pipeline too, because these are not the only think tanks there are. There are other think tanks that are not of this world, actually, from other worlds, other zones, dimensions, realms, etc. They have their determinant think tanks also. And they have a blueprint for the future of this world. Not this only this world, but many worlds. I call it cosmic corporate culture. And so there's this coalition, there's an attempt to kind of blend these two think tanks of this world and think tanks of the cosmic corporate culture, and come up with this new world order, which says we know best what your determinate future needs to be. In order for the greatest good to take place, in order for us to move, evolve, to progress towards our goals of happiness, equality, all this kind of stuff. They have these goals, determinate goals. And again, this is all based on false premise. The mother of all false premises, you might say, is the notion that God created us to produce determinacy, to change reality into determinacy, as if God says, this indeterminate universe, it's no good, I don't really like it, I can do way better than that. So I created you, Spirit, to transform, help me transform this indeterminate reality into a determinate reality. So you're on this righteous, evolving path of working on this. There's nothing more false than that. That's the mother of all false premises. And yet this fuels much of the belief in this world and the belief around the cosmos, indeed, that we're somehow, you know, workers on this, helping this all evolve. And this is the ideology that these think tanks churn out and structure. And we're educated this way. Culture, society reflects all these beliefs. And so we think that we're successful if we enculturate ourselves in this way. And so you have all these people who think they're very spiritual spouting all this determinant nonsense. Because they think, well, I'm helping evolve us evolve spiritually. And those are the ones Jesus criticized so strongly. Those who were spiritually self-righteous in that way, in this way, in a determinate way. And they refused to listen to what he said because they said, Jesus, we're the think tank. We're the smartest ones. There's no way we could possibly be overlooking anything of fundamental importance that you could tell us. And your attitude suggests that you have something of fundamental importance we're overlooking, and this simply isn't possible. Because if we're overlooking it, everyone else is too. And Jesus says, yeah, you're all overlooking it. But there are some humble enough to accept this. And this is what Jesus calls the repentant mind. And that's what Jesus comes. I came for the repentant ones, the sinners, meaning those ones that realize, for one, they have a very severe continuity issue because they're afraid of dropping sensory perception. There'll be no perception at all. And two, they realize that they have faith in Jesus, that there's some intermediate step, some bridge that they can have. But the issue is they're struggling. Am I worthy? Jesus says, worthiness has nothing to do with it. Of course, we're intrinsically worthy. We are indeterminate. We're free. So that's never changed. So how could we even ask, are we worthy? Is freedom worthy to be free? This is questioning God. This is arrogance. Of course we are. So it's only a question of getting over the jitters and accepting this new perception, this Holy Spirit gift perception. Then we think, no, but God might snatch it away from me and plunge me into knowing. No, the Holy Spirit is entirely in tune with our jitters and our trepidations, and this bridge will remain for absolutely for as this new perception will remain absolutely as long as we have the slightest need for it. What kind of God would provide this remedy like this, only to cruelly snatch it away from us and plunge us into the shock of knowing? This is ridiculous to think this way, and yet we have these jitters. So the Holy Spirit knows we have these jitters, and we think, well, we're so ungrateful to the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is completely beyond all of the reactions that we think it might be having. It doesn't have any of those reactions. It simply knows its mission is to hold this vision of oneness, this perception of pure perception of clear light vision of intrinsic spaciousness, to hold this perception for all of us and to attract us to this perception until we all choose it, until we all have absolutely no more need for it whatsoever. This is all that the Holy Spirit is about and nothing else. The Holy Spirit only looks on opportunity. It never sees anything but where is the opportunity that we're giving it, however small it may be, even if it's a little crumb. The Holy Spirit never even has a ripple of reaction to what's taking place. It only is this perfect opportunist of seeing the little willingness we have and then leveraging that, teaching us how to leverage it, being help attracting us to the willing to leverage this. you could say the Holy Spirit is super positive, absolute super positivity without even a ripple of negativity to it. And yet we are not called to be the Holy Spirit. So this is very important. Again, to let me reemphasize, we are not called to be the Holy Spirit. So we are not called to struggle with our reactions and our attitudes and our speech and body and struggle with all this stuff. That's not our calling at all. We're not called to be the same as the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is a creation of God. And it's different than us in its purpose is to bring us to this new perception, this pure perception. It doesn't have any continuity fear, but we do. So again, when we're trying to purify ourselves, this is not the answer. When we're trying to be like the Holy Spirit, that is not the answer. Our goal is to accept this perception. That's our purpose. That's our goal here. The Holy Spirit's already perfect. It's carrying out its mission perfectly. We don't have to do its job. We're not taking over from the Holy Spirit at all. Okay? We will never need to do this job the Holy Spirit's doing. Not ever. The Holy Spirit will remain to bless creation, so it will always be available if we ever choose to try and make the reality determinant again. The Holy Spirit will be there for that, if we should choose that. And never are we ever called to function like the Holy Spirit, function in that way. So in ignorance of this, we keep trying to purify ourselves, or to get instead of practicing, we're trying to act like someone who's trying to help someone bridge the trouble. Now the trouble's already been bridged. So we're just called to this practicing, accepting this. That's it. Again, Jesus was so critical of the Pharisees and the Sadducees, all these very righteous religious practitioners, who they were trying to bridge the gap between perception and knowing. Through all this, all these sacrifices and all this kind of, it leads to this all this crazy, crazy stuff. He says, fools, hypocrites, what are you doing? God has already provided the remedy. See, we're trying to provide the remedy for ourselves, which ultimately is some form of determinism. So it just makes things worse. Longchamp says, give up all your practice, give up trying, give up, all this graduated the path of and just realize you're already there. You already have what you're searching for. But we say, but we didn't produce it. Yeah, God did. See, and that means we're not God, right? Which is the arrogance that we're trying to replace God means that we keep trying to produce our own remedy. This is the trouble. We keep trying to produce our own remedy. As Jesus says, there's absolutely nothing we need to do. He says, there's nothing I need to do except this fact, because the remedy is already present within us. The Holy Spirit holds it there within us, awaiting just for us whenever we want to accept it. So you might say, well, this what religion are you teaching? I'm not teaching any particular religion at all. I take from these various Dharma kings whatever is beneficial for our motivation, and continually bring up right focus. It's really just continually putting the right focus on we need do nothing. The remedy, we already have the remedy. And we practice it. I'm already there. I'm already experiencing this. I've already accepted the remedy, which is a gift of God to us. I've already accepted this remedy. And therefore, I don't need to ask any questions about it. I've already accepted it. That's the end of it, right? And now it's just a matter of getting familiar with it. And the discipline of that. That's a discipline. So we say, I'm already in the swimming pool. I'm already in it. So the key is imagine yourself that you've already stepped into the pool and you're already floating in this pool. So it's too late to ask questions like, well, how do I get in the pool? What do I need to do to get in the pool? Those are already moot, completely moot. All these questions are moot. It's too late for any of these questions to arise. Ridiculous now. You're already in the pool. Now, when you do this practice properly, you'll get kind of butterflies, or there's some trepidation that will arise within you, of course. This is the wow. But just look at this as a positive wow, like wow. This, enjoy the intensity of it. Enjoy the burn. That's what I'm feeling now. I just had this happen. It just sudden like a little leap within you. Your heart takes a leap, so to speak. It's like, oh, it's the leap of recognition right there, right? It's like, oh my God, you take a little leap of recognition. I'm already in the pool. So it's too late for any questions, which we now realize are just forms of delay, clever forms of delay. Camouflage forms of delay. Most religion, most thinking, everything is just camouflage forms of delay. We try to spiritualize it. And this is the trouble going forward in this world. There's so much effort towards spiritualizing delay. So much effort. It's a very scary situation. And you get the yoga girls involved that they're very difficult to say no to turn away from. They project this very strong cheerleader like superficial confidence, and that this form of delay is beautiful. You don't want to leave this. You can't leave it. Nobody wants to leave this. You can't. I don't give you permission to leave it. So this is the trouble, is these yoga girls, these very adept at spiritualizing delay. They say you don't have permission to leave this. So this is where the Dharma Prince steps in and says, I do give you permission. You do have permission. I'm speaking on behalf of all the Dharma kings, and specifically, because we like to have a little bit of structure, I'll say Longchenpa, speaking on behalf of Longchenpa. You do have the permission to practice this way. I can speak and from permission from Jesus Christ too, but it tends to agitate people too much. Whereas Longchenpa, they don't even know who he is, so it's less agitating. But at least there's some structure there. Okay, you're speaking for some Dharma king, and okay, some Dharma king. Okay, not really sure what that is, but at least there's a little structure there, and I like what you're saying, so I'm getting permission. Okay, great. So as we sit on the edge of the pool, if we're hanging around a pool, what we're practicing is we're simply immersed in this belief that we're already in the pool. That sitting on the pool is actually just a hallucination. We're in the pool hallucinating we're sitting on the edge of the pool. Practice like that. And again, the only reaction is just, wow, this precludes the whole spiel of the cheerleader yoga girl thing of say, oh yeah, I feel it, I'm in the pool, it's so great, isn't that great? I mean, and, you know, and then there you go, away spinning the spin towards spiritualizing instead of practicing and experiencing. Spiritualizing delay, because then explanations and questions and it all, the whole ramification, how it, the spin. So we stop the spin from happening by full stop in the wow. That's our only response to our practicing, is just wow, full stop in the wow. We don't allow any elaborations to arise, certainly while we're practicing. Now we can view, one of the things that I do make available here is help us look at the potential elaborations and spiritualization of delay and the various forms that can take and get used to it and just say, oh, okay. And I've done this with like flower frames along Longchenpa. It's I'm getting more used to them now. Now I see it, I just kind of, now it's kind of like, ah, okay. Whereas before, when I first saw it, I said, oh my gosh, this is so beautiful, this is so incredible, this is so wonderful, wow. And how, you know, and your mind starts engaging with that. But now it's kind of like, oh, okay, that's nice, but that doesn't pull me away from practicing like this anymore. You know? So those are helpful. I call it fire breaking. It's a very, very helpful practice we do. We have to understand that's what it's for. Again, you burn the area around your house intentionally, so when the big wildfire comes, it can't jump the fire break. It's already burned. We're already burned out on that, in other words. But this is only effective if we are committed to full stop in the wild practice. So it's only done in that context. So there's no cheerleading. Let the Dharma Prince do the cheerleading if there's any. You have to have faith in the Dharma King, and then those that are speaking on behalf of the Dharma King, and just stick to the practice of wow, full stop in the wow. I don't have anything else to say about, you know, so what about perception? Just wow. So don't feel the pressure of needing to react and spin and use it to spiritualize delay, which is really, use it to spiritualize sensory perception. And yet again, pragmatically, we do some work on backburning it. I produce these videos, graphics and all, that the purpose is to be, allow yourself to be impacted and just wow. So beautiful. Oh, wow, it's so great. Because there is beauty in creativity. That's fine. But then you get back to your practice of I'm already here. And just wow. And that's it. No questions. No answers. The answer to all questions is don't ask the question. There's no need to ask the question because I'm already in the pool. I'm already experiencing pure perception. So the question of how do I get there is moot. And don't ever, the Holy Spirit has this perception for everyone. It's already there for everyone. So don't ever buy into this notion that anyone has to have a determinate path whatsoever. It's absolutely not true. There's the arrogance and continuity fear is still at play, you know, in their minds when they are like this. Because they all say, yeah, I have it, but what about the ones that are so evil and so wicked and they don't have it? I got to help them. No, it's there for everyone. Nobody's ever been evil or wicked because no determinism has ever happened. Nothing we've ever experienced is anything other than our own desire to experience it. So nobody has ever imposed anything upon us. There's no wickedness or evil. It never happened. It never happened. That's a dream. It's a hallucination. We're hallucinating that, sure. But we're already in this pool of perfect indeterminism, of perfect perception of indeterminism, perfect perception of it, pure perception of it. Everyone is. It's just they're hallucinating, they're not. Some more than others. So we don't have to get rid of the hallucinations. This is very important, hear this. We can keep hallucinating we're sitting on the edge of the pool, but we realize it's just a hallucination. We say, okay, I can see hallucinating. But I don't believe it's true at all. I'm experiencing, I'm in the pool. I know that I'm in the pool. I'm experiencing it, directly experiencing it. But I also see that I'm still, for old time's sake, I'm keeping the hallucination that I'm sitting on the edge of the pool, along with everybody else, we're sitting around the pool. But I realize everyone's actually in the pool. Nobody's not in the pool. But for old time's sake, we'll keep the hallucination around for a little while. That's fine. Doesn't hurt anything. I just don't identify myself with it. I realize it's just a hallucination, that I'm a silly hallucination. That I had to play this little game of believing I can be greater than God. So we don't need to get rid of anything. We don't need to get rid of the hallucinations. We merely need to recognize them as such. I do a lot of work in Backburn. I do a lot of work, a lot of graphics. I never have time to publish them. I make some mistakes on them. I say, oh, maybe I better not publish it. But see, this is not understood by most. They think that I'm somehow providing a bridge for them. No. This is just seeing that we're already in the bridge. We're already in the pool of pure perception. And these are just practicing recognizing hallucinations as such, and all the spiritualization is we say, it's not really attractive enough to believe in hallucinations. I'm sticking with pure perception. It helps us with that. I produce some beautiful layouts of Ramaharshi and the quotes of Ramaharshi. Is that to worship Ramaharshi? Is that no. That this is to practice overcoming our temptation towards spiritualization of determinism, because the yoga girls and those who work for them are very adept at utilizing these spiritual teachers and spiritualizing them as if to motivate us to do something. We don't need to do anything. That's the whole point these teachers tell us. We're already in the pool of pure perception. It's already within us. The Holy Spirit put it there within all of us. At concurrent with our desire to dream of separation, concurrent with that desire is the Holy Spirit, God creating the Holy Spirit and placing this pure perception within all of us. So it was put equally at the same moment within all of us. There's nothing anyone has to do. Nothing anyone has to prove anything. So I play with these dazzling graphics, and read these great quotes and do all this stuff, but ultimately one becomes then more and more blasé about it, and less attracted even to that. Beautiful arrays of flowers, just all this just. As much beauty as you can imagine, sensory perception, and then you ultimately realize, it's still stale. It's still flat. It's still stale. It still plausibly infers determinacy. That's not really it. The yoga girls are ferocious. Display, 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 display. Look at this display. Look at this display. Look at this. Look at me. Look at the display I'm putting. Look at the fashion I'm wearing now. Look at this. Look at this. This is attracting sensory perception continuously. Look at the glitter. Look at the glamour. Look at the glitter. Relentless. This is something that has to happen as long as we are trying to believe in the false premise. The yoga girl phenomenon has to arise. The attraction to sensory perception and the belief in determinacy, we have to keep attracting ourselves to it. So the dream is like that. And it's bizarre, and yet it is what it is, right? And so it's that we have to deal with it. And it hasn't changed at all. We thought wrongly, because we were promised this, that feminism promised us it was going to drop all this display and all this attraction to you know, hallucinatory determinant display. And we said, oh, good, great. That'll be so helpful. But did it really happen? No, it didn't. In fact, it's worse than ever. The style changed, but it didn't stop at all. And so it was a false promise from the ego. It was a false promise. Don't ever believe in any promise that the world will drop all this effort towards display. It never will. Sensory perception, this will never do that. It's only, you have to recognize these hallucinations as mere hallucination. The creative display will continue. So it's so irksome, you know, because it's you thought, oh, this is the answer. In other words, women will stop putting on, you know, provocative display, beautiful display of their clothing, the way they are, that they will, you know, wear baggy, nondescript clothing, stop paying all attention to their hair and their makeup and stop jewelry and ornamentation, and now some tried to do this. But they're frustrated within. And they're really ultimately going to loop it back. And what happened was they looped it back towards display. Because that's not really the right practice. It's putting the cart before the horse. So as you go out now around, it's like crazy. You see these women, they're wearing this clothing with all these super intricate, beautiful patterns. And I said, Why are you doing this? Why? What are you trying to attract to? It's crazy. I say, oh, this body is so unbelievably beautiful. I mean, look at this. Look at the patterns on the clothing and the colors and everything. What does that have to do with the body? You know, it's false advertising. And it's attracting us to trying to evolve determinacy, trying to change indeterminacy into determinacy. It's exactly what it's attracting us to. So I respect the effort of many women to not do that. But what happened was they didn't practice in the right way. They just tried to discipline themselves without the full stop and the wow practice. And ultimately, it creates a great deal of trouble that we're feeling now. We're experiencing it now. It's not enough to be helpful. They were trying to be helpful. it's not enough to be helpful. This is what I've discovered now. So if people are saying, well, I just want to be helped. No. Don't help. Practice correctly. Practice your own liberation. And when you start actually practicing your own liberation, you will automatically begin to be clued in about, hey, let me just take the middle path here, but let's knock off this stuff. Let's just have this attitude of, I don't care at all, one way or the other, if anyone's attracted to me, determined to me, meaning the premise of determinancy, which I'm fronting for, cheerleading for, or not. You drop the cheerleader attitude, and you become humble and repentant and realize, wow, this practice is really rather difficult. I mean, I have this continuity fear. So you get very serious, and you're no longer the cheerleader. And this can be felt. You could feel it. It's obvious. You come across a person, and it's especially easy to see it with women, is do they have this cheerleader attitude for determinacy or not? And if they don't, you immediately feel that, hey, I don't really have to pay any attention to them in terms of their form or how they look or anything. And it doesn't bother them at all. They could care less. And so you don't. And it's very helpful. But we cannot rely upon that. Again, we can't rely upon helpfulness. We have to rely upon our own practice. Because the fact of the matter is that this is very rare. And the world is again, full of nonstop attraction towards determinism, towards this premise that our purpose is to change reality into crystallized determinism, time, space, process, and form. And so we have to keep attracting ourselves to this, to bodies, because bodies are our chosen hallucination to keep believing in that we're supposed to do this, and we can do this, and so we have to feel like we're attracted to it. So we have to keep making bodies attractive. We feel this is something that is just no brainer. This is has to happen. This inherently arises from this premise is to keep trying to make the world beautiful and attractive and bodies beautiful and attractive. You can't, if you try to keep the premise but stop being attractive, it creates this conflict in you. So it's better to just leave it as it is and don't try to be helpful. Just repent and practice. And you automatically will have the right attitude. And so don't try to get rid of, all this display, creative display of attractiveness, which women are constantly working on, nonstop. It's just astonishing. It's a complete fixation and obsession, even when it's done subtly. They never stop looking at their appearance and how do I look now, and little adjustment, even if it's in hippie chic or yoga chic or whatever, it's always chic. But there are some who've given that up. They don't really care, but they don't go into grunge chic, because they're obsessed with those in grunge chic, or obsessed, how's my grunge chic looking? Am I, do I look grungy enough? I look in the mirror. I'm looking too sleek. I gotta make myself more grungy. Let me put this makeup on, makes me look more grungy. Let me keep working on the grunge. Constantly be attracted, still being attracted to the body. Whereas those who are practicing, they will still, you comb your hair. I comb my hair. How do I look? A little bit of that. Sure. Do I look presentable? Okay, fine. And then go back to practicing. So let the Barbie dolls, let them be that way. And don't, what we see now is it was a waste of time. All this feminism was a complete waste of time, actually. And so we need to learn from that. There's no point in trying to take half measures and pretending to be helpful when we're not actually doing the right practice. This will only produce conflict, frustration, and backlash And we're experiencing that backlash now. Terrible. So just don't pay attention to them. This is what I do. I mean, just don't, just basically, well, you do the practice of aversion training. And just, I do that every day. Just keep practice that way. This is way better than trying to go through this fast cycle of delay we just went through of hey, you know, you could really help out. Stop, you know, drawing attention to how you look and you know, dressed out and all this. Because, again, that puts the cart before the horse. It creates a terrible backlash, and we end up just wasting our time. So it's way better to simply, as has been done throughout history, just practice aversion training. And so keep the notion of any sort of attractiveness, physical attractiveness, in anyone, really. You immediately substitute that with what I do, for instance. You see a sleek, chic yoga girl. They're everywhere here. It's just, it's like, you go out, they're just surrounded by it. It's like, okay. So I take the physical appearance. Here's a practice, physical appearance, how they look, and view that as merely ornamentation upon a body of a gigantic spider. You know how spiders have these colorful markings on them? Just say, this is just a colorful marking on the body of this gigantic, hairy, vicious spider that is with fangs ready to sink into you, wrap you up in a cocoon, and suck all the blood out of you. Every day they come to suck more blood out of you to keep them going. Okay, view it as that. And they just, you know, it's just like, oh God, I can't be tricked by that. Because actually, this is quite accurate, isn't it? Blood-sucking spiders is really what is taking place here. And these bodies are just this colorful ornamentation. Nature is constantly producing this colorful ornamentation to camouflage the vicious fangs, right? And so the insect or whatever it is, oh, look at this beautiful, colorful, this is so beautiful, attractive. And the fangs snap shut on it. This is how nature works. And it's no different with human bodies either. It's the same. They suck the blood out of you as to keep empowering determinism. As if this we believe by hook or by crook, God given this mandate, we have to change reality into determinism. So we believe, the self-righteous believe, they're doing God's work. They're not doing God's work at all. They're following a hallucination of arrogance. Is all that's taking place. So, this is Vajrayogini has introduced, which is this female form of grace, has introduced this aversion training for us here. And I've been practicing it, and now I'm realizing this is the way to go. If we would have had that back in the 60s, feminism would have never arisen, and we wouldn't be in the situation we're in now, of basically this fascistic feminist reptilian patriarchal coalition that is set to wrap us all up in a cocoon like a giant spider and suck the blood out of us for eons, suck the life force out of us continuously. This is what we're facing right now, this gigantic spider. So if you start thinking the world's a wonderful place, just think it's all this ornamentation of the world is actually just colorful markings on this gigantic spider that's wrapping you up in this terrible cocoon, paralyzing you, and then keeping you just alive enough so you keep producing this blood, then it keeps sucking it from you. This life force keeps sucking it from you. Because this is actually what's taking place here in our hallucination, of course. So if we would have had this aversion training back then, we would never have gone down this road. And yet, we wanted to try one last time. We wanted, the women said, no, give us a chance. We want to be helpful. This is the crux of it, okay? And so I have to step in as a Dharma prince. I have to step in with higher authority than the women of this world, much higher, and say, we're not doing that anymore. We don't want you to be helpful. Okay, we want you to practice. this helpfulness is the dagger. I mean, this is what I've discovered in my life, and will not be happening with me anymore, as to the extent that I can practice and disallow it. And we all pray that this is, 100% capacity. I asked Longchenpa to fill in for any deficiencies I have, that is for sure. And all the Dharma kings have our backs, and Vajrayogini have our back on this one. That start the day with aversion training. Make sure you use that during the day, actually. This will be vastly beneficial to everyone. We will no longer be fooled by this, "Oh, I just want to be helpful. Oh, I can help you out on the path." No, you can't. What you can do is you can practice. That you're already there. "I just want to be helpful." Those are the most dangerous words possible. As Jesus says, it's called helping in order to hurt. And he says this characterizes the ego. Helping in order to hurt. And we fell victim, prey to this once again. And this has put us on the brink of this terrible crisis. We thought that women could be helpful. We don't need women to be helpful. We need them to practice their own realization that they've already succeeded. Okay, this is absolutely crucial from a pragmatic perspective, and we have to be pragmatists. Being spiritual idealist is really stupid. You have to be a pragmatist. Which tells us that we have to practice, that we must insist on practice, not on helpfulness. "Oh, but I could be so helpful." No, I'm not. We're disallowing all helpfulness and insisting on practice. That helpfulness is the worst trap of all. It's the most vicious trap of all. And we are directly experiencing pragmatically the effects of that very vicious trap. Women promised that they were going to stop trying to attract to determinism. Why? What was the quid pro quo of that? Well, you don't really have to practice that you're already there, because we'll help you get there. That was what happened. This is the great deception that happened. We are suffering the effects of the great deception. I mean, the 60s, 70s, 80s, what we've been through last century, really, but very severely, is the great deception. But if we recognize this, we can say, "Oh, okay, I see how I was deceived." Eve deceived us again, so to speak. That dynamic of sensory perception, the dynamic of the false premise, has to deceive. It's the only way that we can continue to keep experiencing this, is we have to deceive ourselves. And so we have to have a deceptive temptress, so to speak. That aspect has to be there, and then you have to have the foolish one that falls for it. Well, both, you see. It's not one or the other. It's both. What use is the temptress if nobody falls for it? So the false premise we have that God created us to change reality has to have both the deceiver and the deceived. Has to. But we don't need to play either one of those roles now. So I'm not playing either, the role of the one being deceived. I'm giving that up. I'm no longer deceived. And so there's no purpose for the role of deceiver either. The one that says, "Oh, I just want to help." That's the deceiver. That's how it works. I don't want you to help. I want you to practice. You don't need to help. Nobody needs help. We're already there. We just need to practice accepting this. And that's a direct practice that each of us has to do. And then they say, oh, you don't want me to back off of display? Well, then I'm just going to go into intense display. I said, suit yourself. I'm going to use intense aversion practice on that. So they tried to strong arm us, saying, well, if you don't allow me to help, I'm going to hurt you then. Say, do whatever you want. I'm not going to pay any attention. I only call to practice here that you're already in the pool of indeterminacy, in the pool of pure perception. We're already in the pool of pure perception. Simply practice that, and our response is simply, wow. And again, it's attitude. You can dress pretty much any way you want to, as long as your attitude is one is oriented in the right direction. Then people simply realize you're not into trying to attract them, trying to deceive them at all. And so they really don't really pay any attention how you look, really. It's a hallucination, okay, that's fine. So as long as we have this false premise, we'll think we have to keep trying. And so it's useless to legislate behavior and appearance and everything. Completely useless. You'll only create backlash, as we have seen. It's useless to make these promises if we keep the wrong premise, which is what has happened. Useless. Ultimately, it comes back and bites us very badly, and we're getting bitten really badly right now. So we don't give any prescription, really, except practice. That we're already finished. That we don't need any practice. The Holy Spirit already has this perception for us. We don't need to attain anything. We already have it. And we don't need to try to generate determinism. God did not create us for that at all. We completely made this up and arrogated this to God and said, and put policy in God's mouth, that God doesn't have this policy at all. We just tried to stuff it in God's mouth and say, this is what God wants for us. Nonsense. Now, if you give out sumptuary laws, then the women will just say, okay, we're helping you out. We're following these sumptuary laws, and we're helping you out. And that's sufficient. We're doing our part. No, they're not doing their part. They're not practicing abidance in the pool of pure perception. They're already in that pool. They say, oh, well, we'll make it easier for you. Not really, because at some point, there'll be backlash from the help, severe backlash, which makes it more difficult. The only way to help anyone is to practice. Help yourself to practicing, right practice. So we will continue to practice aversion treatment. Absolutely, absolutely. And what they say is, this is what they say: if you agree not to practice aversion practice, I'll agree to stop dressing in a certain way. I'll be very humble and meek and modest and all that. If you agree no aversion, that's just setting you up, right, for laziness. And then later on, they'll change their tune for sure. We know this is a fact. Suddenly, it's amazing. You get there's just this woman who I saw that dressed very grungy. Okay, suddenly. One day she showed up, and she was a glamour queen. I said, what the heck? And now suddenly, she's playing to attractiveness. Suddenly shifted, just like that. Now, if you have let all your practice slide, and you don't have aversion practice, you're not willing to do that, suddenly you're very, very vulnerable to that. So, never make that deal that you're going to drop aversion practice That's off the table as far as any deal goes. Completely off the table. We will practice this way. You find that those who want to help, they're always actually making a deal that you back off your practicing in exchange for them. And if you don't do that, they're going to torment you, they think, through, dress as provocatively as possible, try to attract you as much as possible, torment you. They're going to try. So it's really a threat. It's really a threat. This helpfulness always carries a threat with it. It is what Jesus pointed out. Helping in order to hurt. So we're going to have this aversion to any form, at a beautiful form at all, the notion of any beautiful body whatsoever. It will be a severe aversion to it. Now, of course, they're terrified. They go, "Oh my gosh, well, God's going to, we're going to realize this was all arrogance, and that I'm going to have to drop perception, and then I'm going to be overwhelmed by no." Well, they're completely ignoring the teaching here then, and the practice, which is the Holy Spirit has placed a new form of perception, which is clear light vision of intrinsic spaciousness, and we all have this, and there's no way we can. If there's any fear of leaping directly to knowing at all, the Holy Spirit will attract you to this pure perception. Now, if you have no fear, continuity fear at all, then the Holy Spirit will say, "Great, go ahead, leap right into knowing." But there's virtually nobody that falls into that category whatsoever. Sure, if you can do that, the Holy Spirit will not stand in your way at all, of course. So, there you go. It's what thing is the arrogance insists that it can't, there can't possibly be any other form of perception. Well, that's ignorance of the Holy Spirit. It's ignorance of the grace of God. It's unrepentantness. And those are the ones who say, "I just want to help you. I just want to help you." What do you mean? If you were aware of this other form of perception, you would say, "I just want to practice." You wouldn't be saying, "I just want to help you." You'd be saying, "I just want to practice," and you would be practicing. And not in a resentful way at all, but in a serious way. And you'd have respect. You'd have respect. And you'd understand. You say, "Okay, I get it. I'm all right. You're okay with me. What you're saying is perfectly fine. No trouble. This helps me focus on practicing. And I understand I'm not a problem to you. If I'm practicing, it's not a problem." It's not the attitude. You see, the attitude. Because they realize that, "Well, I don't have to deceive anymore. It's not necessary. We all have this perception. I just need to realize it, and that's all that everybody else needs to do also. So we don't have this problem that we must continue along and keep sensory perception going. We don't have to. Sensory perception is doomed to extinction from the very beginning. So look at it this way: it's completely doomed. Look at the world and say it's absolutely doomed to extinction. All bodies doomed to extinction, totally. And of course, what we're really saying is sensory perception is doomed to extinction. Because we're perceiving the world through sensory perception. So it gets back to sensory perception. It's, "Oh, yeah, wow. That's right. So I better practice this other pure perception." And not how to get to pure perception. Right? We already have it. Not how did I get it? It was given to as a gift by God. That's the answer. We didn't do anything to get it. Well, how do I keep it? We don't do anything to keep it. The Holy Spirit keeps it for us. So there's nothing I have to do except just experience it. And we practice as if we already are experiencing it. Say, "I'm already experiencing pure perception. I'm already experiencing pure perception." Now, this trouble didn't just start in the 60s. It's always been going on. It just took on a very strong form then of promise, very strong promises, which of course were empty promises. And now the backlash is unprecedented, very unprecedented. You cannot give up being a cheerleader for determinism unless you change the premise that you operate under. It's impossible. So it's just empty promises you can't fulfill. It's like a check you can't write. You can't cash the checks. Like wrote a bunch of checks to everyone, and you go to the bank and say, well, they don't have any money. It's empty. It's a worthless check. It's a worthless check. There's no money to back it up at all. And so we're holding all these worthless checks that we think that we're going to be, we're empowered by all this, these promises, and there's no empowerment at all from these promises. And so it's like so many are feeling destitute in the world right now that I notice is because they're holding worthless paper. It's worthless paper. We thought, oh, this is going to bring about a new age that we'll truly be spiritually empowered. And we got nothing, actually. But we don't want to admit it. But it's time to admit it, that these were all blank checks that were written. Not blank checks, worthless checks. I promise to, you know, bring about this golden spiritual age because I will stop, you know, attracting you to away from what, you know, I will drop that and you will not be disturbed by that anymore. And everyone will be very modest and will be able to, you know, all this stuff. Whatever promises, they're empty promises, they're worthless promises because the premise hasn't been changed at all. It's the thing of the story about someone trying to get across a river, a pilgrim, a monk trying to get across a river, sadhu, and the snake showed up and says, I'll take you across the river. And he says, oh, but snake, you're poisonous snake, you'll bite me. He says, no, the snake says, come on, I promise I'll take you across. So the snake takes him across the river, and as they're getting off the snake's back, the snake bites him. And it's a snake, you know, he promised me. He says, well, I took you across the river, didn't I? I didn't promise I wouldn't bite you once you get to the other side. I promise. So the backlash comes at some point. They said, sure, you can engage in all these forms of spirituality, which we have. But they said, well, I didn't promise I wouldn't bite you at some point. I just said you can engage in all these you know, forms of spirituality, which we did. So, see, they didn't really promise. But we thought, oh, well, that, you know, it's going to work for us. It didn't work for us, did it? It doesn't work. The snake bites us again. Unless you have gotten wise to this. So I've tried to alert everyone. I'm trying to alert everyone. Because I know everyone's holding this worthless paper. And they're vulnerable to this new world order. It's obvious. Nobody seems to have any resistance to it except anger. That just means that they don't know how to really deal with it at all. If you knew how to deal with it, you wouldn't be, you know, just wallowing in fear and anger. There could be some righteous indignation about it all, but wallowing in all this and paranoia and fear, no, we don't do that here. We know the way to be free of this and to not get fooled again. Aversion training has to be brought in the picture. Vajrayogini brought it into the picture. Sri Sri Anandamayi brought it into the picture. And I accepted it because coming from her is you know, it seems like the only way we can accept it is coming from a woman itself saying, look, this is what you need to practice this. So if this practice comes from a woman, coming from Sri Sri Anandamayi, a female aspect of grace, we tend to listen and accept it. Whereas if a man gave it to us, we like Jesus, we would say, ah, Jesus, I don't know. I mean, I'm not quite ready to practice that or whatever. Yeah. And this is where the rubber really meets the road here. Truly it is. And very understandable. We keep thinking we have value. We have all these checks. That we'll be able to cash these checks. Go to the bank to cash them, and the bank says, these are worthless. And we're terrified of this. But this full stop in the wild practice overcomes the fear of this. Because we don't need to leap into knowing. When we see all these worthless checks, say, oh my God, I got to abandon sensory perception completely. I got tricked again. And yet not realizing there's this other perception for us, we think we have to leap into knowing, at which point we become terrified, and then we run to the yoga girl and say, oh my God, please attract me back into this deterministic hallucination. I'm terrified. And yoga girls say, no problem, that's what we're here for. We have all these practices for you that'll work great for you. And you say, oh, thank you, Mother. You're so wonderful. That's so great. Oh, gosh. This is what happens over and over and over again. I'm just speaking of the history of this world, is it not? We run back into the mother's arms and say, oh, my gosh, attract me back to it. I'm terrified. Yeah, but you gave me all these worthless gestures. Well, that was just, you know, because you wanted to, but I knew you'd come back to me anyway. Yeah, it's like, oh, yeah, you're right. Okay. And then we're, you know, stuck again. Stuck in the middle again, right? Terrible. And so many are headed directly for that. But not here. Not here. We're aware of the situation and continue to shed light upon it. We're practicing aversion practice. It works. It's like almost like a physical shock. You shock your nervous, you shock yourself deeply, like, wow, my God, that really is this hideous spider. Oh. It's not, you know, it's pleasantly unpleasant. Because you realize how important it is and you embrace it and I said, I should have practiced this way all along. What about, wow, but better late than never, especially now. There's never been a time when better late than never was more appropriate saying. Because we, just in several days of practicing this aversion practice, it can actually make the difference between success and failure. Just practicing a little bit, and you will suddenly find vast clarity arising for you. This is exactly what I've experienced. Now, we don't need to spend time praising Sri Sri Anandamaya Ma, because every time I do, she says, no, I don't need it. Practice. Don't praise. Practice. I say, yeah, but this is so incredibly helpful. No, don't praise. I don't need it. Nobody needs it. Just practice this. I only care about your success, not about you praising me or anything like that. Just practice this. So the very notion of turning towards attractive form, physical form, is just hideous. You see this hideous, vast spider walking towards you with all its multifaceted eyes on its forehead, and it's sensing your vulnerability, and it has this, on its belly, this bloated black belly, it has this pattern of a beautiful figure, beautiful human form in beautiful clothing and ornamentation and everything, and it's walking towards you, and it's hoping that you keep be mesmerized by this marking on its bloated belly, hideous black belly, and its eight legs are walking towards you like this, and its fangs foaming are ready to devour you, and you go, say, get away. No, back to practice. I'm actually in this pool of pure perception. It's like a hideous nightmare suddenly arises every time you start to think about beautiful form. It's hideous nightmare arises, but you do it intentionally. This is high practice. It's the practice that we didn't do, which is why we're in this terrible situation right now. Because he said, no, but you know, this display, all this display is so attractive. I don't, you know, I want to kind of keep indulging in it. You know, yeah, I want to say no, bad. But maybe we can like spiritualize it in some way, so we can keep doing it. I don't really want, you know, we fudge it and we don't do it. And now we're paying the hideous price, or about to. Just see Hillary Clinton as just a marking on this hideous, black, shiny black, monstrous spider that is just abhorrent, and it just causes you just to wake up from the dream just instantly. Oh, no, I can't even picture her at all. It's impossible. Use that. Because, of course, she's commanding a vast army of yoga girls. A vast army indeed. Are just markings on this grotesque spider. It just gives you the creeps. So it's an amazing thing. I mean, we've spent our whole life trying to avoid the creeps, but now we're intentionally producing them to ourselves. This is astonishing. You would think it's the last thing you'd ever try, but in trying it, I find it supremely effective. Supremely effective. Doesn't bother me at all. In fact, I love it. I welcome it. Because I realize the treachery that it is waking us up from. Absolute treachery. And again, this whole dream of arrogance has to be treacherous. And it takes two, the tango. It takes the treachery and then the fool that falls for it, right? And generally, the men play the role of the fools and the women play the role of the treacherous sirens. So we're freeing ourselves from both roles as we do this aversion practice. I'm no longer the fool. And why? Because I no longer pay any attention to the sirens. What siren? I don't see any sirens. I just see this hideous foaming spider coming at me. Like that. Now, I used to have this arachnophobia. It was terrible. But what it really was this aversion, desire to practice aversion practice that I didn't do. And eventually, in curing that aversion to spiders, I end up falling into the trap, of attraction to spiritualizedness, So now that's that's good. I should have just had this terrible aversion. And yet, this is the one thing in the world that worldly people will not accept. They think you're crazy if you do this. Well, let them think that. They're just offering you treachery is all they're offering you. They're saying you're crazy not to be a fool for treachery. Really? And never before in the history of the world is this so apparent right now, is the treachery in the world to come. We're more aware of this than ever before. Okay, so we're actually at a place where we can actually accept this aversion training. I accepted it because I saw how hideous the future is going to be. I was given visions of what it's going to be like. And these continue. And I say, oh my gosh, I welcome this aversion practice. It's tremendous. I welcome it because the treachery we're walking into is just massively hideous. It's not just one spider. It's like an entire universe of hideous spiders crawling all over your flesh continuously. Just imagine that. Isn't it better to just see one hideous spider and jump back from it and then see ourselves in its pool of pure perception? Isn't that better than an entire universe of monstrously hideous spiders continuously crawling all over our flesh and we're lying there paralyzed watching them crawl over our flesh and we're just screaming in terror? Because this is what's coming in the world. This is what is actually coming. And it's this yoga girl treachery and these foolish morons falling for it. Fools playing the fool, which is leading us right into this hideous pit. The pit is just full of writhing poisonous snakes and hideous spiders. And we're about to fall into that pit. We're on a thin thread of grace. Only God's grace keeps us from falling into this hideous pit. Now, this sounds like the revival of Protestant revival. Yeah, well, it is. It's the true end times revival is right here, actually, because we have these very skillful understanding and skillful means given to us by the Dharma kings. So this is really the highest grace, is the fear of God is the highest grace, it's called, meaning practicing this aversion to this false notion of God, the attraction to this completely false notion of God. We must practice aversion because we put all efforts to make it attractive to us, and we demand that it be attractive to us, and we work so much and insist that everyone must find some form, way to be attracted to it. And yet we're saying, absolutely not. We are seeing how hideous it really is. Wow. And then recognizing there's this intermediate perception, this pure perception. This is all we're called to, is pure perception. We're not called to knowing at all. We're called to pure perception. Have these teachers, Dharma kings, gone into knowing? Yes, they have. But they also come out of it too. They also, there's some grace where they're capable of helping out as a bodhisattva to function with pure perception. So maybe the final dissolution into knowing hasn't taken place for them. I don't know. I have to ask them about that. But it's neither here nor there. The fact is they call us to pure perception, plain and simple. They're not calling us to knowing. None of them are. They're not calling us to knowing. They're calling us to pure perception, to the, as Jesus says, the vision of Christ, the vision of oneness. Others say the vision of equalness, the vision of intrinsic spaciousness. Clear light vision of intrinsic spaciousness is a very accurate description of it, you would say. Clear light vision of intrinsic spaciousness. It's not nearly as warm today. It's all cloudy. It's fact, it's not warm at all. It's amazing. It's cooled way off from yesterday. But it's a beautiful day in its own way. Different mood to the day. I keep hitting my weight goals. I'm still on it. Still on it. Barely. Amazing. I have to keep eating because I'm working out, and you got to replace the muscle that you're tearing down, you know, to build it up even stronger. So I've got to be careful to keep eating. If I just, you know, crash diet at this point and keep working out, that's going to be a problem. So it's better to just hit your weight and get stronger than it is to try and get, you know, even reduce even more. This is how I see it. It's just so okay. But I am hitting my weight, barely. That's good. So I keep the discipline going. Keep drinking, you know, smoothies. Strawberry, blueberry, peach. Fruit smoothies with protein powder in them. Probably I need to get back to the veggie smoothies. I believe I'm going to have to do that. Add a little more discipline to the day. I'm going to have to do that. I don't know why I keep getting away from it. Because it, you need that green vegetable stuff too. But I'm eating vegetables in the evening time, so I'm okay with that. But a nice kale, spinach, strawberry smoothie is excellent. What was that juice I was using that masked the kale? There was some drink liquid I was using that anyway, whatever fruit juice you use, it actually masks the taste of it pretty well. And I strain it, which is the key. I strain it, so it takes time. That's why I'm planning on doing it. I strain all the pulp of the kale and spinach out of it, and then you can just drink it right down. Now the purists will say, no, you need the pulp. You need the pulp. You come on, leave it in, leave the stems, leave everything in. That's what the goodness is for you. But yeah, but you can't really. It's not very palatable. So extract the juice. If the pulp is unpalatable, go ahead and extract the juice anyway. And whatever the health nuts will say, no. Bake a muffin with all the kale pulp. Gotta have the pulp. Hey. It's like lemon juice. I strain the pulp out of that too and make a lemonade. Strain the seeds, strain the pulp. They say, no, juice it all up. Well, guess what? When I juice it all up like a lemon, it tastes terrible. The seeds are terrible. They give a terrible taste to it. They say, no, leave all the seeds in. No. I can leave the pulp in, sure. That's fine. But you get enough goodness out of it anyway. So if that's a deal breaker, strain the pulp out, okay? It's just it takes time. I don't have an extracting juicer. That would be nice, actually, to have an extracting juicer. Just you know, extract the juice from the kale. And the spinach. I have a blender that's designed to keep the pulp in, to keep the health nut purists happy. Oh, good. Don't forget the seeds. You know, make sure you're getting those too. Lots of nutrients. Yeah, lots of bitterness in them too. Yuck. Yeah, the most dangerous word of all. I just want to know how I can be helpful. Those are the most dangerous words of all. That should put you on immediate high alert. That there's a treacherous deal being offered you. What it really means is I just want to know how I can structure this treachery in a way that you'll accept it. That's what they're really saying. That's it. Again, adherence to this attempt to change reality is completely treacherous. It's constantly offering us nothing but treachery and the misery, the hideous misery, the torment, the fear that follows. Imagine you're falling in this pit, this dark, slimy pit, full of Ebola and smallpox and cholera and cancer and leprosy and every hideous pus disease possible. And you're lying in that pool of pus, drinking that, and these hideous spiders and snakes are slithering over you. This is what I just want to know how I can help you. That's offering. This is. I just want to know how to get you into that pit. That's all. I just want to know how to get you into that pit. Whatever it takes. You want a nice song and dance? Sure, I'll do it. As long as you agree to go into that pit. That's all that it is. Instead, just practice. Nobody has to ask you. I just want to know how to help. Well, we have a practice. Full stop on the wow. It can be explained in 30 seconds. That's the end of it. Just practice then. Start practicing. Full stop on the wow. I'm already in the pool. I can, I will, I'm already there. This is it. I can, I will, I'm already there. And just wow. And just practice. You have it. You have the practice. Nothing else needs to be really said. Except continual reinforcement that you have the practice. Now practice. That's it. I don't want help. I don't need help. Nobody wants help. We want practice. Oh yeah, but I'm doing that. But I just want to know how to help. No, you mean, okay? Is that what it takes? If I practice, will you jump in that treacherous pit then? No, under no circumstances will we jump in the treacherous pit. There's no deals to be made, but then I won't practice. Well, suit yourself. That means you were just trying to make a treacherous deal. See? Sure, people will pretend to practice and say, okay, if that's what it takes to get you into that treacherous pit. And see, under no circumstances will I go into that treacherous pit. Well, there's zero deals being made here at all. But there is the grace of practice being explained here. There's this pure perception available to you. So avail yourself of that, and you won't need to make any treacherous deals anymore. And you will find yourself actually waking up to this, and then you will just have gratitude towards God. If you want to help have gratitude towards the teachers, to just practice. That's the only gratitude they're looking for. That's the only one they need, right? Just gratitude to practice. Wake up. Start seeing the treachery for what it is. It has to be treacherous, and it is. We have to keep fooling ourselves. We have to keep deceiving ourselves. We have to keep producing more and more attractive forms of treachery to make that jumping into that horrible, slimy pit make it seem attractive. The siren is at the edge of the pit saying, oh, come here, come into my arms. As you come into her arms, oh, she falls into the pit. She goes, that's okay. Yeah. Feminism is like saying to you, hey, when you fall into the pit, this dark, slimy pit of horrible, poisonous snakes and hideous, pus-infected disease and gigantic spiders crawling over you, but when you fall into it in the arms of a yoga girl, it's a wonderful fall. You'll enjoy the fall so much. But if you fall into it not in the arms of your girl and so on, it'll be a hideous, terrible fall. You know, are we supposed to believe that? That's okay. Oh, good. Because this is what we've bought into. That if you fall off the cliff, you're going to have this hideous, terrible fall as you're falling in this hideous pit. Oh, it's such a terrible fall. But if you fall in the pit in the arms of a yoga girl, it will be this wonderful, beautiful, blissful fall. Everything will be great. Yeah, what a nice fall. No harm at all. No trouble at all. Oh, really? I find myself down in the bottom of that pit? Then what? Oh, gee, you know, too bad. Isn't that awful? Well, what a shame. So who, again, I'm going to put this to everyone. Who would buy this nonsense that there's this cliff? You're on the edge of the cliff. And if you jump off the edge of the cliff, of course, you could be, this rocks, boy, you'd be dashed to pieces on the rocks. So you say, I'm not going to do that. I'm going to back away from the edge. Now, what if a yoga girl says, look, no, 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 just embrace me and we'll jump together. And it'll be fine. You'll be fine. Who is going to accept that? Who among us is going to say, oh, okay, so I won't be dashed to pieces on the rocks, but no, it'll be a wonderful fall. You'll enjoy the fall. No harm will come to you. Who's going to do that? Who's going to jump with the yoga girl off the cliff? Because literally, it is worse than that, actually. This is what we're being offered. Who is foolish enough to accept that? Apparently, a lot of us. Because that's what they're saying. I mean, they say, look, you're going to have to jump off the cliff one way or the other. You might as well jump off in my arms. And yeah, you'll be dashed to pieces, but you'll be fine. Don't worry. You'll be happy fall. Happy fall. Might as well have a happy fall. So wait a minute. Isn't there a third option? My back away from the cliff? No, no, no. What are you talking about? That's insanity. That you're talking about complete insanity. He says, no, wait, isn't there spiritual practice, full stop on the wow, where I gradually overcome the jitters of realizing I'm already in this pool of pure perception, which is an intermediate step back to knowing, so there is no insanity at all? I mean, I actually had this wonderful, clear sanity. No, 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 there's no such thing. You know, what are you talking about? That's crazy. We would know if there was such a thing, because we're such wonderful, spiritualized yoga girls, so intelligent, super smart. There's no way we could overlook anything so important. No, no, no. If you draw a step back from the cliff, you're going into this just complete insanity. You'll completely lose your mind and be in total chaos, mental chaos. I say, well, that's not what I've experienced. I've experienced this wonderful path of gradually evaporating my continuity fear. And more and more I realize I'm already in the pool of pure perception, resting in the pool of pure perception. And all this images of rest, of being around the pool are just hallucinations. I was never there. I'm already, and I'm enjoying the path immensely, actually. I love the stress and the strain of it, and the interest in it, and the drama of it. It's wonderful. There's no insanity at all. I'm getting clearer and clearer and clearer and clearer and clearer, more and more sane all the time. So, yoga girl, you're entirely mistaken. Totally ignorant and mistaken. Therefore, you don't have any authority at all. My authority that I invested in me now as an official in the court of the Dharma, Omniscient Dharma King Lakchenpa, completely trumps any spurious authority you have, which is just based on ignorance, actually, and the threat that ignorance seems to provide to us. So it's just intimidation and bullying and threat instead of genuine authority at all. So I say, with authority invested in me, is to for everyone to practice. The Holy Spirit is a fact. Pure perception is a fact. The fact we already have it is a fact. All we need to do is accept this, get used to accepting it. And we need to, the only reaction we have to our path is just wow. That's it, just wow. We don't have other elaborations as far as our reaction go. Just wow. And we just stop with that. We don't elaborate or explain the wow. There's nothing to explain, nothing to elaborate. It's intrinsically understood in all of us. Who are we kidding? The idea of elaboration is that there's someone who doesn't have this pure perception within them, which is a lie. The Holy Spirit is equally put it within all of us and equally keeps it within all of us forever. We're all have perfect standing in the one reality, everyone, one of us. No differentiation whatsoever, no higher, no lower. So nobody needs to elaborate. It's intrinsically, the wow is intrinsically understood in everyone. So always go into practice that I'm going to experience the burn and the wow. Not that I'm just going to fake the practice so that I can be more treacherous, saying, okay, now I did the practice suggestion, now what are you going to do for me? I'm not going to do anything for you. I've already done everything, which is give you the practice. So what are you going to do for me is practice. That's all. I don't need to give anyone. There's no deal. I've already given everything of value. So now, again, is what are you going to give to me? All I ask is just practice. That's it. It's the only thing that has any value. Everything else is a worthless check. A bounce check. Everything else is just a bounce check. A check waiting to bounce. It's just a check waiting to bounce. You have a business. Do you spend your whole time accepting checks that are just waiting to bounce? You know they're going to bounce every time you go to the bank. They bounce. Are you going to keep accepting those checks? Well, buying into the New World Order is doing exactly that. Saying, I'm willing to perpetually accept bounce checks. I have no value whatsoever to me. How could you stay in business that way? You're going to end up in a very dark hole. All you have to do is experience the bird. It's enjoyable, the bird. It's like working out. You like the burn when you're working out, don't you? In fact, yeah, you say, it was not too bad, but you say, okay, let me work a little harder. Oh, you feel it. Oh, that's cool. The endorphins rush comes in. You say, that's good. It's a nice burn. I like that. Yeah, it takes, you have to push yourself a little bit. Yeah, absolutely. It's worth it. The alternative is hideous. Look at it that way. Instead of saying, well, is it really worth, how good is it? Look at the alternative and see how hideous the alternative is. And that should, that's all that needs to be said. So I have the gift of putting the fear of rejecting God into people. The fear of rejecting God is truly hideous. And you're sitting there thinking you got everything, and all you got is checks waiting to bounce. A check that's bound to bounce is all you have. And when you thought you could buy your way out of the pit, now you say, okay. They say, okay, no, I don't have to go in the pit. I got all these checks. Really? Okay, well, we want to. You got to pay us in gold. Go cash the checks and give us the gold. Say, okay. You go to the bank. Check bounces. This one bounces. They all bounce. And they say, these are worthless. And he'd say, oh my God. And then the yoga girls say, okay, time to embrace us and fall into the pit. You don't have any value. In the pit is where you'll find value, you see. The pit of still trying to keep boosting determinism, the belief in determinism, is a hideous pit of conflict, of inner conflict. Of inner conflict. Really, all conflict is inner. We just keep trying to project it out onto these hallucinations and then have conflict with the hallucinations and then produce a winner. And we think, okay, that got rid of the scapegoated loser took our inner conflict with them. This is folly. This is insanity. Never works, does it? The inner conflict always remains as long as we have this false premise of believing that our purpose is to change the nature of reality. We will be bedeviled by this inner conflict, terrible inner conflict. Because we're attracted back to reality, we think we're trying to leave God. We're rebelling against God. We think we're rebelling against God. We don't really want to do this. It doesn't work. We can't figure it out. We're not good enough. All these feelings of insecurity, insufficiency, rebellion against God. No, we're rebelling against this false premise. And it doesn't matter how you put all the myths together. It all boils down to the same thing. It's a false premise that we believe came from God, in which it did not. So you can talk about Lucifer, and which side is Lucifer on? Is Lucifer helping us see that the rebellion against God is a good thing because this is really a rebellion against a false premise that we think is God? Or is it Lucifer saying that rebelling against this false premise is actually bad and you need to stop doing that? However you want to play it. I mean, the Gnostics play it one way, Christians play it another way. It doesn't matter. It's still a false premise, and it's not God. It's not God's premise at all. So turning away from that is certainly accepting God's will. It is absolutely God's will that we remain as we are, which is completely free and indeterminate. So, serving this false premise, it's God's will that we're free to do that. But it will never be God's will that we can produce an iota of determinacy. We never. So we're frustrated and frightened of a continuity fear. And there's all this boiling frustration, insufficiency, guilt that we don't really want to do this. All this stuff is within us intrinsically as long as we accept this false premise. And then this gets projected out and played out with all these dramas of who's the bad guy? Who's the bad guy? Where is that, you know, what is causing me this terrible stuff? You know, there must be against God, you know, they're God haters. You know? So just practice. You're already in the pool of pure perception. There isn't any other way. Just role play that. You're already in the pool. Now, abidance is possible. The trouble we have is when we open our eyes, so to speak, and see all these figures around the pool and say, oh my gosh, I've got to get back to what I am. I was just dreaming that I was in this pool. No. Those are just hallucinations. So just let them remain hallucinations. Don't try to get rid of your hallucinations. Because you're then taking them to be somewhat determinate. So we have glimpses of abidance and truth, but then we don't abide in it. So our goal is abidance. So we can imagine we're in this, we can feel we're in this pool of pure perception, like a meditation. But then when we come out of the meditation, it's like, oh, I was just meditating. I'm really on the side of the pool. That's not true. What it is we want the meditation to be continuous in that we make this shift. The shift is in seeing that these figures in the world on the edge of the pool, around the pool, and the chairs, you know, deck chairs or the pool chairs, those are all just hallucinations. The real me, that what I really am, is actually in the pool. And we don't need to get those hallucinations to come in the pool. This is very important. We don't. They're just hallucinations. There's nothing. But the real, what we really are, is in the pool already. That's all that's needed. So it's when we think we, oh my gosh, I need, those hallucinations are part of what I am. I need to bring these into the pool. This is where the struggle comes and we lose our abidance. I got my all white on today. White shorts, long sleeve white shirt. First time I've done this. Very interesting. Stepping into my role, official role here. What are we doing? We're working on abidance, right? So we've just unearthed an extremely important dynamic here. And we'll just sit here. And wow that. Just wow it. When I say just wow it, meaning don't elaborate upon it, on your reactions. Refuse to elaborate on your reactions. It's very important. This is how we lose our way, is the therapy, modern therapy, the yoga girl, whole thing, everything that's going on, is they say, well, elaborate. It's helpful if you just elaborate. In other words, decorate your reaction. Elaborate upon it. We want to know more about it. No, just the opposite. We refuse to elaborate upon it. This is the key. So there's two adamant pillars that we seem to have, is we refuse to elaborate on the wow. All reactions are lumped together into this one non-elaborated wow. And we practice aversion practice too. It's like taking your vitamins every day, right? Got to stay strong in that way. Because I'm telling you, as we're warned, the whores of Babylon will be deployed. These harlots will be deployed. They're being deployed already. You do double take, you know. You say, what the heck? If you're walking along a public street, you say, what the heck? You know, wow, that's distracting. You don't expect that. You don't expect that level of distraction. And again, our habits are to be fooled. Play the fool. Play the idiot and be fooled into display. So, of course, we're going to react at some level. And we have to practice, make sure that's knocked out. Quickly knocked out. We have a quick remedy for it. Very quick remedy for it. boom, hit it with aversion practice. Gone. Evaporated. And we're right back in our practicing, just like that. But, you know, if we think that in this world right now that we're not going to be absolutely hammered by every kind of form of attraction possible, then we're deluded. We most certainly will be. And we're already getting hammered very severely. And now you can cut out all movies, television, magazines, everything, but you still gotta be out in public in some way. I mean, pretty much so. We can cut back on that too. I mean, the adepts, they just spend time in a cave most of the time, but in today's world, it's pretty rough to do that. Gotta go to the market, you know. You go to the market, it's just crazy. Here, just crazy. I mean, the women are just dressed like harlots, plain and simple. They act like harlots, plain and simple. I don't see any difference at all. It's just okay now to be that way. This is socially acceptable. In fact, it's encouraged. All right, one second here. I'm getting some.